I would like to welcome you all in our last lecture. It is a very sad moment, but inshallah, it's not going to be the last live sessions with me, inshallah. I will be always delivering live sessions to you gentlemen whenever you need to. Just only, this is the last session to cover the PMP material that we need for the PMP exam. As you are aware that we are going to cover now the monitoring and controlling processes, as well as the closing process of the PMP process package. So we'll cover today 12 processes that are falling under the monitoring and controlling process group and the single process that fall under the closing process. Some of you will say, Muhammad, mashallah, 13 processes in one lecture. Why don't you segregate these into two lectures? Valid question. Well, it is much easier than you think about it. It's very easy, but only for those who have done the effort. If you go now to the Rita book, the first chapter, what you will see over there, what is the classification of this chapter, which is what? Which is the monitoring controlling. As you can see here, the project monitoring and controlling process group is considered to be the most difficult process group. It is like when you go to a guy who is at his fifth year in the university, and you ask him, how was your fifth year? Was it easier than your orientation year or not? Well, it depends, okay? Those who have spent the time doing what it takes in the first year, and the second year, and the third year, now is the time to enjoy the time that you have invested in the previous four process groups, let's say. So in our case here, those who have spent time learning about the initiation, planning, execution, now is the time to enjoy the monitoring, controlling, and closing. These are not heavy, but they are interconnected with those other process groups. That's why the difficulty is there. For your information, how many items of the PMP checklist we have as our homework in this week? Just if you go back to the notes I sent you, okay, if you go there, you'll find there how many items that are part of your homework. You have only 14. 1-4 tools and techniques compared to the previous weeks where you have 33, some weeks you have 25. Now you have only 14, which means that a lot of the tools and techniques that you have learned so far, okay, you will reuse them again, okay? And our, as usual in our lecture, it's not our really focus to cover the tools and techniques. We will cover only those most important things. Those that you can simply go and refer back to the book and read, this is just simply, it's going to be part of your homework. So can you see over here, it is not difficult in terms of material. It is difficult in terms of focus. How the monitoring controlling are interfering with the other process groups. Because let me give you an example that can show you how the monitoring and controlling is happening maybe in the planning. For example, When I am performing my planning activities, okay, I need to make sure that my planning work is going according to the charter. I'm not planning to something else. It's very important that I can see how my planning is going in alignment with the charter. How my charter is in alignment with my what? With my business need. Can you see? So it is a verb. It is an action I am doing, okay? That's why the confusion is there. Those who memorize, it will be a hard time for them when it comes to the monitoring controlling. Those who understand, believe me, they will enjoy it. And we'll see this clearly, inshallah, in the coming review session. How the monitoring controlling are easy for those who understand, and how they are difficult for what? For those who memorize. Let us now, as usual, see how the monitoring and controlling fit into the picture of the PMP. We said that in the initiation, we have identified the stakeholders and we have authorized the project and provided the project manager with the required authority through the project charter. And after that, we went to the planning. The planning and the execution are a prerequisite for what? For the monitoring and controlling. So in the planning stage, I am setting the guidelines. I'm setting the baselines, the reference points that I will use where in my execution to come up with the deliverables. Where I will use also the plan to in the monitoring and controlling to make sure my produced deliverables are in alignment with the plan as well as the need. Remember the two checkpoints we talked about before? We'll cover it in this lecture in more details. Can you see this? So when you go to the agenda of this meeting, okay, which is almost 13 processes that some of you say, oh, too much. No, sorry, it's not too much. It's just a checkpoint, okay, for all the guidelines that we set. So can you see here for chapter 4 as an example, we have two checkpoints that are represented by the monitoring control, project work, and the perform integrated change control. Don't worry if you are not familiar with the process name, we'll show you the meaning in a very easy language as we go through this. We have our checkpoint for the scope. We have already set a baseline in the beginning for the scope. Now is the time to control the scope. Make sure that we don't have scope creep. It's the time to do validate scope, which is our second checkpoint, validation. We'll cover this into detail. Validate scope is basically the validation where I'm checking my deliverables against the business need. Here, I'm gonna control my schedule. If I am deviating from the schedule, I will do certain actions, either preventive or corrective, to make sure I finish the project on schedule. Same thing with the cost. I have control cost, control quality, control resources. What's the difference here? Control resources are for those non-human resources. The management of the resources, the human resources, have been done in the execution. So in the monitoring and controlling, I'm doing it for the non-human resources, for the equipment, for the facilities. This is the process is all about. Then I will have monitor communication. Remember, I have a communication management plan. I need to make sure I am executing the communication management plan as planned, okay? Same thing with the monitor risk. I have a risk management plan. I need to watch out. Do I have new risks that just have been just newly introduced? So they will subject you to a changes to the reserves that you set in place. Okay. Then you have the control procurement. Can you see here? I am having control processes for all knowledge areas. So you need to memorize. This, what we will cover today, is as simple as controlling whatever we have planned earlier. That's it. And do some changes to the plan as required. Maybe while I'm in the execution, I discover that some part of my plan need to be changed. And these are the change requests I'm doing in the execution, okay? When I'm executing, I say, oh, there is something that is not correct. So this is a preventive action. That's why I'm going back to the plan and I'm making the changes. I'm not doing any rework. It is a good change because if I'm gonna execute that crappy plan, I will end up with a lot of mistakes, a lot of defects in my deliverables. Can you see that? And we will see this clearly, inshallah. And at the end of the day, we'll go ahead with our bye-bye process, which is the closed project or phase process. Okay? Very easy. Believe me, it's very easy for those who have invested the time. Those who have memorized, please come. I am offering a consultation sessions for those who are still sick. If you know also any of your friends who are just not attending the sessions, I'm still gonna help you guys until you take your certification. Whether you have attended the sessions before or you did not, please approach me to make a corrective. Let's do monitoring controlling with you. Let's make sure that you go back on plan. Okay. So let's apply the knowledge we are going to gain in this lecture, inshallah, to you. Okay. So let's go ahead. What's the first thing that we need to do over here? Do you remember that we have a discussion about the data information and report in lecture one? And we understood that data is simply the raw data that came from execution that need to be analyzed by the monitoring and controlling, okay? And need to be consolidated in the monitoring and controlling. So data is converted to information through monitoring and controlling, and information is converted to report using the monitoring and controlling, okay? And then those reports will be used in the communication, which is part of the execution. And we covered this before. And just to help you see what we are talking about, it is already available here. So I start with my execution. Here is the data. Then in the controlling, it was converted to the information. And then there is an integration controlling process, which is 4.5, as you can see here on the right, that converted what? The information from the input side to the report on the output side. Then the report will go back to the execution process, which is what? The managed communication. And I have as the output what? The project communications will be sent to whom? To my stakeholders. So I'm already engaging my stakeholders by giving them the required reports. Okay. Now, all what we will cover now is just more details. How we are doing that kind of conversion to the information. How I'm doing that kind of reporting. How I'm doing it. Can you, Muhammad, show me the process? How I'm developing the report? And who are the end users of those reports? Who are they? I want to see them, the end users of the reports. And the moment I see the end users of the reports, then I will see, okay, now how this will lead to the MCC or to the mechanical completion of my project. I need to see the link because ultimately after the session, khalas, we'll say bye-bye. Okay, this is the last lecture. So I need to make sure that I have a clear closing for my lecture. Okay, so if I was failing in showing you the final thing, please tell me, Muhammad, I still did not see how we close the material. Show us how. So again, let's just go and see how we are taking the deliverables, the data, how we are taking the data from the execution, as you can see here, and converting it to the information, then to the report, then to the end users of the reports. I will use with you now what a sample of the monitoring controlling process. Any monitoring and controlling process will have this kind of setup. So I'm choosing this process as our sample. So as you can see from the title, this is a sample of the monitoring controlling process. Any monitoring controlling process will have data as the input. Because what's the main intention of monitoring controlling? I'm comparing plan versus actuals. So the actuals are represented by what? By the data that you can see on the screen. The reference are represented by the plans. Okay? And think of the project documents as the supplements, as the attachments of the project management plan. Okay? So I need to have what? I need to have references and actuals for me to analyze the data and come up with what? With information. This is a useful information. So in here, for example, I'm doing what? Control scope. So the information will be what? Oh, there is a scope creep. I need to change my deliverable. I'm providing extra, which is not acceptable, okay? So this is how you do what? Change request. There is some person who have changed the plan. I need to make the changes. No, it's not as per what? There is a scope creep. It's not in alignment with the business case and the charter I have in place. Okay, so again, I could have a corrective action or I could do a preventive action. What is the difference between these two? Preventive action is proactive action. Corrective action is after the fact. It is reactive. Compare between these two. So change request could be a corrective action or could be what? A preventive action. And this will lead to basically to updates, to lead to different processes. And we'll see this clearly. So as we said here, we have the information sent to whom? To the process that will consolidate all the information and produce what? The report. Okay, so what I will use as a common sense, as a tool and technique for this process, I will have different tools and techniques for data analysis because I have data as an input. So there are different ways to analyze the data and come up with information. Okay. And based on the information I got, there could be a change request, okay? And the change request will be sent to the decision makers. So always when you see 4.6, put between parentheses, decision making. This is where you make the decision making, okay? So I need to receive all the requests to the decision makers who can make the decision. And we'll cover this inshallah in detail just in a couple of slides. Is that clear? So in here we have seen a sample of our monitoring controlling. So if you go to your homework, which is the 12 processes, you'll see this, you see the same. You'll have reference, okay? You'll find attachment to that reference, which could be updated as a result of this process. I will have actuals, which is the data. And I will have what, as usual, the OPAs and EAF. Some of you will say, Muhammad, I don't have here, for example, OPA, EAF. Again, you could have this as an input. Even if the PMI did not show you this as an input, remember, this is the best practice. The exam question will not tell you, and the process number, control scope. Is the EEF an input? No, because as you can see here, you can see here enterprise, okay? So again, you may have, if you want to, you may have the enterprise environmental factors as your input, no issue. This is only what you see here is the best practice. So don't think you'll have a closed-minded exam that will test you on those small details that are not meaningful. Okay, I hope you understand now. So now any monitoring controlling process will subject you to updates, will give you change request, and will give you information. Now we have seen now how the conversion had happened from the data to the information. Now let us see how the information will be converted to report using what? This process. So information was an output of what? Control scope, and it is now an input to what? To my monitoring control project work, which is 4.5. Okay, and we can see this in the next one. Report development. It's happening where? In 4.5. So, can you see here? As an input, I have information. And the information did not come only from the control scope. It could come from any monitoring and controlling process. As long as I'm doing analysis over there, I will produce information that may require change request, that may subject you to update the reports. Okay? So here you can see as the input, I have here the sources of information. As you can see here, the information came from where? From monitoring and controlling processes. Can you see here? I have here 10 processes that belong to the monitoring and controlling process group. Okay? That will be consolidated in this process, and I will have report as the output. And I can see here who are the end users of the report. maybe many of you did not recognize what is the document I'm using right now. It's a very golden page. It's called the data flow diagram. It is showing you the process, it's showing you the input, and showing you the output of the process. It is a kind of map, and it is already with you. For some of you, maybe you never investigated the document I gave to you. It is part of what the PMP golden pages. So you'll find 49 data flow diagrams for all the processes that I gave to you already. So in this case, you have already a data flow diagram for which process? For 4.5. And as you can see, it shows you, okay, I have the information and it provides me the information from these sources and the output will be sent back to these processes. Can you see here? It makes a link between chapter 4 and chapter 9 and chapter 10 and chapter 11 and chapter 8 and 7 and 5. Again, the most complex thing or easiest thing in PMP, if you are able to see the connection between all knowledge areas. Eventually, at the end of the day, you will take the exam as a project manager, as an integration manager, as a person who's gonna integrate everything together. That's why it's very important that you make the link. If you find this difficult, it means you should not handle a project manager position, okay? Because it's either you understand what you are doing, so you'll enjoy your life when you are a project manager, or your life will be miserable, okay? So as you can see here, I have seen how I came up to the report. Now your homework will be what, simply? Just to see what are the tools and techniques I have used to come up with the report. How I have made the conversion from the information to the report. Just go over the tools and techniques, and believe me, it will be easy for you to understand. And as you can see here, for sure, I will need my report to my execution process, the one that we have covered before. I need to have the report to be sent to my stakeholders and my project team members. And we have seen this before in the famous diagram that I always refer to. I needed to do evaluation to my team and the managed team. I needed to have a feedback. Okay, this is the report that show me how my team is performing. So based on that, I will do corrective action. I will try to find for him a corrective plan by inspiring him, by influencing him. Okay? Also, the decision makers. The decision makers will not go to site and will see what's going on. They will make a decision from their head office. They will see the report and they will say they will see the change request. And based on the report and the change request, they will come up to a resolution, to a decision. Okay? That's why it's very important that you see who are going to use the report. And we can see here there are different end users of the report. Make sure you understand, okay, make a link. Very important in the PMP. I have the charter for the plan. I have a plan to come up with execution. The moment I execute, I have deliverables, which will produce data. The data is required to be analyzed to have the information. And the information I need to come up with the report. And the report I needed to make communication. I need the report to make decision making. Can you see how things are connected? If you don't make the connection, you will not enjoy PMP. Make sure you make the connection. Review, go back, seek the connection with me. Okay? Now we have seen the reports. And we have seen how these reports will be sent to different end users. Now I have the information, okay? And we have seen that it will be, one of the end users will be what? The execution process, which is what? The managed communication. As you can see here, I have the input reports, and it will go to whom? Project, I will have the output as project communications will be sent to everybody, okay? Here is one of the problems many of you will sometimes face when he was studying the execution process. He said, Muhammad, how come managed communication is execution? How come input is monitoring control? How come? I cannot understand. This is this is the question of the guy who will memorize. Again, the one who will understand, it will make sense. what I will communicate, report. How I will produce the report? I need to analyze. I need to do monitoring control to produce the report. I hope now it makes sense by now. What else? Who else the end user of the report? The decision-making process, which is what the perform integrated change control. I believe you have heard this many times, that many of the exam questions are coming on change request, right? And in the upcoming couple of minutes, okay, if you understand what I'm gonna say in the coming 5 or 10 minutes, I guarantee you, you'll solve all the questions that are related to the change request questions. Perform integrated change control. As I said before, it is the decision-making process. This is where the decision maker is making a decision based on a feedback. So I have the report that is representing what is being done on site. I have my references, my plan, as usual. I have my project management plan as my input, okay? In addition to the what? To the report. And I also have the changes. What are the proposed changes that need to take a place? And based on that, I'll make a decision over here. Either to approve the change request, or to reject the change request, or to defer the change request. Maybe I didn't need to make the decision right now. I need to wait a little bit. Once things change, then I will come to a point that I will make a decision. Okay? So that's why you can predict the tools and techniques that are required to perform this process as soft skills, as decision-making tools and techniques. Okay? And as you can see here, the input will be what? As we said, will be the report, which is from 4.5, which is the previous process that we covered. I have, as usual, my plan, which is my reference with the attachment over here. And I have what else? The sources of changes. This is very important to see over here. You need to ask yourself, what are the sources of changes? Many of you came to me at the time of the Rita game, if you recall that. And he asked me, Muhammad, why we have a change request in the initiation column? Oh, we did not do the kickoff meeting. Why? Some of you say, why we have change request in the planning? Why we have change request in the execution? Why we have change request in the monitoring control? Now you'll have the answer again, because we gave you the answer before, but now, because of the importance of this, we need to tell you this again. One example we did yesterday, where I have identified stakeholders in the execution of the project. So I'm gonna use an initiation process in the execution. Again, why I am calling it initiation process? Because the majority of the stakeholders are identified in the initiation stage. But that does not mean I will not identify the stakeholders later on. I will do so later on for sure. That's why you'll find some of the changes are coming from an initiation process. Some of you will say, okay, Muhammad, why I'm using planning processes in the execution? For example, while I'm monitoring the risk, I discovered, wait a minute, and I have a new risk. So the moment I have a new risk, I need to apply all the 5 planning processes of risk management on that newly identified risk. Can you see that? So I will reuse the same processes. I need to identify the risk. I need to evaluate the risk qualitatively. I need to evaluate the risk quantitatively, if required, as per the risk management plan. And based on that, I need to develop a risk response plan, okay? And that's why I need to do a change request to change my risk register, to change my risk response plan for the newly identified risk during the execution. Can you see that? So I could use an identification process during the execution. I could use planning processes during the execution. And I hope that is clear for you right now. So now you will see here what the different sources of change requests from all of the four process groups: initiation, planning, execution, and monitoring controlling. And to make your life easier, what I have done, I put a color coding just to make this clear to you. So as you can see here, the one that is highlighted in the green, this is the initiation process, which is the identify stakeholders. The two items that are highlighted in yellow, these are the two planning processes that will lead to what? Will lead to change request. Okay? You will find those that are highlighted in blue, those are the ones that are execution processes that will lead to change request. The ones that are highlighted in pink, these are the processes that will lead to change request from the monitoring and controlling. So can you see here, I have 17 different processes that will lead to change request. That is why many people say it is difficult, because you don't know from where the change request will come. It could come from the initiation, plan, execution. And I will evaluate the change where and the monitoring and controlling. Can you see how things are combined? For those who are getting the point, congratulations for acquiring the PMP exam. I'm telling you from now, okay? Let me see how many people here. I have 41 people, okay? 41, congratulations. You'll take the PMP exam if you understand. If you don't, please, consultation meeting. Call me, Muhammad, I couldn't get it. Please make so. Make sure you do so. I have one friend of yours who came to me and told me tomorrow the PMI will announce about the PMP exam. They will announce when they will do the online. So you can take it from whom, like Ali Sinawi, our beloved colleague. Congratulations, Ali, if you are here. Maybe you are already sleeping. But anyway, congratulations for Ali. He did it in Khurais. He's just next door, so he's just 5 meters away from me, and he did his PMI exam over here, okay? So it's also you who can do your PMP exam in your home, and do share with us your success from your home as well. So no need to do like before, travel to Bahrain or somewhere else. Inshallah, things will become easy in the coming period. So just work hard, make sure you study hard, so you will make best use of the review session that we will do next Sunday. Okay, and as a result, what I will have here, who ask yourself, okay, I make the changes. Now I will send this back to whom? To my execution process, to implement the changes. So that's why you'll find, for example, here, if I have an approved changes, because again, PMI, I believe they did the mistake. You'll find always the output is approved change request. But again, it's not all the time approved. It could be approved, it could be rejected, it could be deferred. That's why I put this in my writing, just to emphasize that you may have approved change request, maybe rejected, maybe approved. So usually the approved change request, it will be sent back to whom? To the execution process to do the rework. Okay? So I will execute the changes. Who's also the end user of that changes? It will be the control quality. Okay? So in the control quality stage, what I will do, maybe I am the quality inspection. I will highlight, let me just see. You can see, I hope things are going fine. Okay, there is nothing urgent. So when it comes to my change request, okay, it will go to my control quality. Okay, so the guy who gave me the change request, he will see, okay, what's the changes? Okay. The authority person have approved the change request. So inspection, so the execution manpower, please do it as per plan. So the moment you bring him the deliverables, he will check the deliverables again as the approved changes. And he will make sure that the executed deliverables is as per what? As per the plan or the change request that is approved. Also you'll find also the control procurement, and as usual, any monitoring controlling will subject you to updates to what? To the project management plan and project documents. So we can see here, this is the stage that I'm making the decisions. We are planning to have, let's say, a break, because the break will be just, you know, we'll cover the earned value management, okay, which is a very important concept. We'll cover, inshallah, after the break, inshallah. So bear with me. Now we have already understood what the process that is there to make the changes and approve the changes, and as a result, come and send the result of change request to the end users. Ask yourself, Muhammad, you told me about the checkpoints. You told me in the beginning, I remember lecture one or lecture two, you told me in the PMP story, if you recall, this was our PMP story, if you recall. And when we come here in the execution, what I told you, if you remember, I told you that before I go to the closing, I need to do two checkpoints, which is verification and validation. And what I said in the verification, I will compare my deliverables, which is the output of what of my execution processes, to my plan. And this is, we call it what? Verification. And this basically can be done by the quality control people. Quality control, they are checking the deliverables versus the plans. And they are asking you for changes, as an example. And you may also, what's the second checkpoint? When I compare my execution or my deliverables to what? To my why, to my purpose, to my business case. And this is what we call it, what? Validation. So now it's only the time to see the processes that does this. Okay? Nothing more than that. So let's first of all check the process that will do for me the verification. Common sense, what will be the input of verification? The process that will do me the verification. It will be simply what? The deliverables that will come from where? From the execution processes. Okay? So if you go here to your verification process, which is this one over here, you can see the input is what? As you can see here, this is the one. I have deliverables as my input. Can you see this? Data as usual, we said this before. Data is the input as usual. Deliverables is the one that I need to verify. How my deliverables are compared to the plan. Okay? So as usual, the inspection department will either accept the deliverables or they will what? They will accept or they will reject. Depending on the IFC package, which is the issued for construction package, the planning, the guidelines, okay? And this is what will happen over here, if you can see here. I have here my IFC, which is my plan, okay? And I have my documentations over here. And based on that, I will come to the decision. Either I will do what? I will accept. Or I will do what? I will reject, which is represented by the change request. Can you see that over here, how our real life process is happening over here? So if it is accepted by the inspection department, it will go to whom? To the proponent. I always call this the proponent process, proponent process, the validated scope, okay? So if it is accepted, it will go to the proponent in the validated scope. If it is rejected, it will go back to whom? To the decision makers. Can you see this? And the information, as usual, it will be sent to whom? To the monitoring control to develop what? As we said before, the report. Very important to make the link. Okay? And as usual, any monitoring controlling will subject you to updates. Can you see this one over here? The quality control measurements. Can you tell me this was an input to which process? Think for 5 seconds. Quality control measurements. If you recall, this was a number to what? To 8.2. Manage quality. Why is that? Because the moment I see the corruption in the deliverables, I will look for optimization opportunities to optimize my process. Because I can see here, after seeing a lot of defects over here, okay, I need to optimize my process. That's why this will go back again to my managed quality. And this can be seen clearly where, if you go back to my golden pages, can you see here in my managed quality, okay, maybe this is not clear over here. If I show you my quality management processes, you'll find in manage quality, okay, I have what? Can you see this over here? In the input, I have quality control measurements, which came from where? From 8.3. Control quality. Can you see that? How these are linked together? Okay. So again, what was the main outcome of this process? I took the deliverables, I did a quality check, again as the plan, and I came with what? With verified deliverables, okay? After I come up with verified deliverables, is now the time to do validation by the customer to make sure the produced deliverables as per the business need. MashaAllah, you give me a restaurant that is very fancy, very tasty food, very nice decoration, but my friend, I need a barber shop. Now Corona, I need a barber shop. I didn't eat. I need to take out my beer. Okay, that's why I need barber shop. That's why here I'm gonna compare the deliverables versus what versus the business need. That's where you find always the quality control people are disciplined. You'll find mechanical inspector, civil inspector, whatsoever. You'll find a specialty over here. While when you go to the validate scope, usually you'll find a one person. In my case, I know there will be a one person who's going to close the items that are required for the closeout. So in validation, so given those have been already accepted by the inspection department, let's say, okay, now same thing with the proponent. The proponent will either accept your deliverable or do what? Or reject. Okay, and as usual, if it's rejected, it will go back to the decision makers. Okay, if it is accepted, it will go back to my final process. Can you see how PMP is nice? Things are coming logically. If I accept, خلاص, because now this is our last lecture. Okay, so خلاص, the accepted deliverables will go to whom? To the closed project or phase. Is that clear? Accepted deliverables. Can you see the difference? Here it was verified. Very important. It was verified deliverables. It means it was verified by the quality control team. Then it was accepted by the customer. Make sure you distinguish between the difference between what? Verified deliverables and accepted deliverables. Okay? And as a result, I will have my last process, which is what? Close project. Which is the final process. Here, the closed project, I will bring everything I have done. I will bring the charter, I will bring the business case, I will bring the project management plan, I will bring everything. Because after this stage, I will say bye-bye to the project manager. The project manager will go to another project, okay? So for me as a customer, I want to make sure that everything was delivered as proposed. That's why you'll find as an input to this process, I have the charter, I have the plan, I have all the documentations, I have my accepted deliverables, which was just an input from the previous process. I have my procurement documentations, my agreement, my business case, my OPAs. Also, can you see here? So what's my ultimate goal? This is an Aramco called MCC, the Mechanical Completion Certificate, which is called the final product transition, the final product handover to the customer. Okay? So this basically, again, it will go, as you can see here, my lovely guy, the customer. Okay? Very nice data flow diagram. Okay? And here is the time where I will capture the final lessons learned. خلاص. I will gather all the lessons learned, and I will update my project documentations, which will be archived to my what? To my OPA. Do you remember? Archiving the documentations will be at the end of the project, and I will update my what? My lessons learned repository, my organizational process assets, so they can be used by other project management team maybe. Okay? And I will have my final report and the final organization process assets updates. Okay? And this is the final process of PMP. Khalas. PMP finish. We have only one last thing to cover, which is the earned value management. Okay? I will just give you a break, let's say, of 4 minutes. Because why I'm giving you 4 minutes, I'm very peaceful because earned value management, it is one of the hassle of many people. They dislike the PMP exam because some of you are maybe have been 10 years since he graduated. Some of you maybe 15 years. And because of that kind of gap, he doesn't like calculations. He forget about how to memorize formulas, how to use formulas. That's why, due to the importance, I will give you 4 minutes as a break. I will see you again at 8:51. Go, take your break, and come back to me at 8:51. Okay? See you at 8:51. Awesome. If you hear me, just ask me your question later on so I can answer you in front of everyone. It's like happening like those who go and smoke and they just spend so much time smoking, so they're not yet back. Okay? But inshallah, I'll just give a brief introduction until they come back. Make sure that you have your A4 paper whatsoever, because now always when it comes to something that is sometimes that is difficult, I always recommend to have your piece of paper in front of you. We'll do it one by one, so we make sure that the information is stick into your mind. Okay, what we will discuss now, even my iPad, I'll take it like piece of paper so I can write with you right now. Okay, make sure you have your paper, pencil, everything with you so we can start our education about the earned value management. So let us go ahead with our earned value one by one, okay, until you understand and absorb the idea. Earned value management. Basically, this is something that you do in the monitoring and controlling process group, and it is one of the homework you will have. If you recall, we said that we have 14 items that is part of your homework. The earned value management is one of the 13. So we just gonna minimize your homework by one by going through the earned value management. You need to ask yourself the first usual question, why? Why? Anything you do in your life, ask why. If you don't have an answer to the why question, you will have a big trouble. Why I'm using earned value management? To measure my performance. Okay? I need to have an instrument in my project management tools that should be there to give me an indication. Oh, behind budget, ahead of schedule, behind schedule. How I'm performing, I need to see, I need to have an instrument. So we can say that earned value management, it is your instrument that will indicate whether you need to do any corrective action, preventive action, whatsoever, to make your project go back on track. Okay? Is it helpful in all of the scenarios? The answer is no. There is a drawback. There is a disadvantage of earned value management. What is the disadvantage of this tool? It can tell me how I am performing in terms of schedule. It can tell me how I am performing in terms of cost. But it cannot tell me if my project is going to fulfill the need that was originally intended. So I can verify, but I cannot validate. In simple terms, I can verify, but I cannot validate. I cannot make sure that my deliverable is fulfilling the business need by this technique. You may receive some questions about that. Keep this in your mind. Okay? And maybe those of you who got this, maybe he can share it later on, even in the group. Waheed, since you have the access, you can share it later on. Okay? How we will understand this? Because here we have a lot of formulas, okay? That you can see it over here. This is the formulas. But I don't anyone to memorize. I hate memorizing. That's why my students should hate memorizing, and they should understand. Okay, let us go back to the time when we memorized that velocity is equal to the distance over time, and when we memorized that the acceleration is equal to the velocity square over time. Is it velocity? No, it is the velocity over time. And again, in simple terms, I need to understand the velocity is what the changes in distance. In that second, what's the delta in distance per time? I need to understand. This is how I measure my speed. How many kilometers I'm moving per time? Same thing with my acceleration. How my velocity is changing per time? So without an understanding of this basic, so if I don't understand the basic quantities like the distance and time, I cannot understand the derived quantity. They call this derived. Okay? And this is basic quantity. Those who does not understand distance, who does not understand the meaning of time, they cannot understand velocity. Same thing with earned value management. There are basic quantities or basic variables and there are derived variables. If you don't understand the basic variables, you will not be able to understand the derived variables. Same as the velocity, distance, and time. If I understand distance and time, I will be able to understand velocity for sure. So let us see the distance and time of what? Of earned value. Let me just take this over here. Make it small. So maybe I may refer back to it later on. What is the basic quantities? Let me just share it with you in the beginning. I have something called actual cost. And the shortcut for this is what? AC. From the name, actual cost is what? Actual cost, the cost I have spent, okay? What's the second thing over here? After the actual cost, I have what? The planned value, PV. What's the third quantity I have? Earned value, which is the title, EV. Okay. The first thing you need to ask yourself, what's the unit? Because I understand that in the time, the unit is what? Seconds. The distance, the unit is what? Kilometer, meter, metric. It's like a distance, kilometer, whatsoever. I need to understand what's the unit over here for these quantities. Because this will help me have an understanding of these quantities. So for your information, these are all have a unit of what? Dollar. So actual cost is in dollar, in dollar, in dollar. All of them are in dollar. Why? Because the PMP exam is written by Americans. So that's why the currency is US dollar. But you can apply the earned value management in Saudi Arabia and you can have the unit as Saudi Riyal. Okay? Now let me understand. Again, Muhammad, actual cost is Chinese, planned value is Chinese, earned value Chinese. Okay? And in the exam, if I don't understand the scenario being stated, I will not be able to use these Chinese terms. So it's very important that I understand what is the meaning of these. So let's just, by a green line, show the lifespan of a project. So this is the start. This is the end. Right? So when you go to from the start to the end, okay, let me just make this so I can see it. So this is the end of your project. This is the start, okay? In the beginning of the project, what I have? I have budget. I have a schedule. I have a couple of baselines at the beginning, right? And at the end of the project, I will have budget. And here, we call it what? There's another one of the variables called what? The budget at completion, which is called BAC. Okay? Budget at completion. So this value most likely will be where here? The budget at completion. Okay. Again, this is in the ideal scenario. Your budget at completion will simply equal to what? Your cost baseline. Okay. Your budget at completion is equal to the baseline. Because what I'm assuming that whatever budget I have in the beginning, I end up with the same, which is very rare, the scenario. Right? That's why I have the actual budget at completion is called what? EAC. I will write this down for the importance of this. Estimate at completion, which is EAC, is equal to what? What does it mean? Actual budget at completion. So if you see budget at completion, this is the theoretical. This is the one I came up with the beginning. So the budget at completion is simply, I'm assuming that the budget I got, it's the same. So the cost baseline never changed. No change requests were there to change my cost baseline. Okay. However, the estimate at completion, it is the real budget that I will end up my project with. So this is like a forecast. So this is a forecast quantity, a forecasted quantity. What are the basic, because in our example, we said the velocity is a derived quantity. The distance and time are basic. Those that are highlighted are simply the basic quantities, okay? The estimate at completion are derived quantity, and we'll see the formula, how we can build it. But I cannot build it unless I understand the meaning of actual cost, planned value, earned value, budget at completion. Let us agree now that we understood the meaning of budget at completion. It is simply the cost baseline, okay? And if I end my project at the, if my estimate at completion is equal to the budget at completion, it means I have a very ideal scenario, okay? Which is rarely the case. You will not find any project in life will have the same budget exactly with no changes. Impossible, okay? That's why it's impossible to have your budget at completion is equal to what? To your estimate at completion. And it's very rare, unless you have a theoretical question in the exam, okay? Now let us understand what? The actual cost, planned value, and earned value. You need to understand that what? I need to just to shift this a little bit to the right so I have space. Okay, I will put this in pink because it's very important. The actual cost is what? Focus here, very important. The actual cost, how much I have already spent from my budget. How much actual cost from the name, actual cost. How much I have spent from my budget, okay? So this is related to what? To the cost, okay? Planned value, how much I'm supposed to spend on that date. Again, planned value, how much I need to spend by that proposed date. So this is related to what? To the time. I will review this later, okay? Earned value is what? When I complete this scope of work, how much I should have spent? So the earned value is related to what? To the scope. Again, let me repeat this again. The actual cost, how much I actually spent, regardless of whether I am behind the schedule, blah, blah, blah. How much I spent? How much, for example, I have 5 million in my budget. How much I have spent from the 5 million? How much? Regardless of how much I spent. This is the actual cost. Planned value, I have an expenditure plan, okay? So by the second month of my project, I should have spent 2 million, okay? By the third month of my project, I should have spent 5 million, okay? So the planned value is related to time. How much I have spent on that date? That's why it's related to the time. The earned value, it's related to the scope. I don't care about the time. I don't care about the cost. I'm watching what's completed in terms of scope. Well, I have built two walls with a roof. So that scope of work, how much does it worth? So I'm just trying to estimate the complete scope of work, how much does it worth? So that's why it's related to what? To the scope. This is related to the time, and this is related to the cost. Okay? And usually, and most of the time, these are measured at the same period of time. So at this period of time, I will measure what is my, let's say this is period one, what is my AC1, what is my PV1, what's my EV1, okay? Same thing in here, they will measure at the same time. In time two, what is my AC2, what's my PV2, what's my EV2, okay? Again, I cannot, in my calculation, use AC1 with PV2 and EV2, no. خلاص, when you do your calculation, you do it at the same period of time. And I want to measure my performance in this period of time. I want to measure my performance at this period of time. Okay? Remember, I am here to measure my performance. Now, what I need to do, I need to build my derived quantities. Because I am ultimately after what? I'm after seeing, am I ahead of schedule or behind the schedule? Am I above budget or below budget? Okay? How I'm performing in terms of time and cost. So this is the main thing over here that we will cover right now. So I hope by now you understood what's the meaning of the budget at completion, which is the cost baseline, the estimate at completion, which is the actual budget at completion, the actual cost, how much I have actually spent from the budget, the planned value, how much I have spent, I should have spent in that kind of date, and the earned value, as per the scope of work that was completed, how much that scope worth of money. Okay? So let me just, minimize this so I have more space. Now I want to measure my schedule performance. Okay? What is the way to measure my schedule performance? I'm gonna write this in gray just to visualize the derived quantities from the basic quantities. So I have here, first of all, my schedule variance. Okay? Which is called SV. Run your logic over here, okay? I want to measure what my schedule, okay? So what I will do, I want to compare my scope versus my time, because this is how I can measure how much I have completed for my scope of work compared to the time. So I will compare my scope with my what? With my time, which is PV. When you read this, think of like, it's like a scope minus time. This is the best way to see it, okay? This is the way to understand it. So if this value is positive, I'll just highlight this in green, I am good. If I am less than zero, so let me just put zero over here. If I am less than zero, which means it's negative, I'll just use pink to indicate it's bad. So this is the way. So if your schedule variance is positive, you are ahead of schedule. If your schedule variance is negative, you are behind schedule. Okay? This is the way to calculate your what, to measure your schedule performance. What's the other parameter for a schedule as well? I will write it here. It is my schedule performance index. SPI, they call it. It is the same as the schedule variance. But instead of having a difference, it's a ratio, okay? Let me just, delete this so we can have space. So having said that, it will be what? It will be EV over PV, okay? And this is how I'm gonna measure my what? My schedule. And I can tell, if this is above one, I'm doing good. If it is less than one, I'm doing bad. Okay? This is for the schedule. Now it is the time to look at my cost. Agree? Same thing. Oh, let me put my cost, let's say, in green. My cost variance. Just try to predict. What's the formula? Cost variance. CV. I'm now comparing my scope versus not my time, my scope versus my cost. Okay? So I'm gonna compare my scope minus my what? Minus my cost, which is this. So again, scope minus time. This is the easiest way to think about. Minus money, cost. Okay? Same thing. If it is positive, I'm doing good. If it's negative, I'm doing bad. same thing with the cost performance index, which is the CPI, it's the ratio only. So it will be the EV, the earned value, the scope, over what? The AC, which is the actual cost. Is that clear? What are the other derived quantities? So now we have seen the measures that I'm using for the schedule variance, but still I want to see what are the variables, or let's say the derived variables that will help me forecast. Because the performance, it will always look at the past, okay? If you see that. Always, when I see schedule variance, I'm looking at the past. How much I have done so far. But I cannot yet tell how I will be doing in the future. I need to forecast. Do you remember? Two of the items that are available in the project documents are schedule forecast and cost forecast that I'm doing now from the monitoring controlling, okay? So what I will do now, what are the elements that will help me do the forecast? Two quantities. One of them is what? This one, which is the estimate at completion. And what's the other variable? It is the one from this moment where I'm measuring my performance to the completion. What we call this? ETC. Okay? Can you predict what's ETC? So let's put here, let me find another color. Let's go with black. So ETC, so I'm putting the color of forecasting, you know, in black. ETC, you can think of it as what? Budget at completion, okay? My budget at completion minus what? The current moment, which is what? Some of you will say earned value. No, I want to be real. How much is remaining? So I will go to the actual cost. So it will be minus AC, okay? However, you know, this is not realistic. Why? Because this is ideal. For sure, I will not have my budget at completion. I need to have the actual budget at completion, which is what? So this will be, rather than this, okay? It will be what? Estimate at completion, which is my actual budget at completion, minus what? My AC. Can this make sense to you? Because at here, I have already spent AC. AV represents the scope, but I care about how much money I need more, okay? How much money I need more, I need to look at the actual cost. That's why it is what? It's EAC minus AC. Estimate at completion minus what? Actual cost, okay? Now, some of you will ask, Muhammad, what is the EAC? How we can collect the EAC, the estimate at completion? Here is the most challenging thing, but believe me, it will be easy with Muhammad Shahab. Don't worry about that, okay? Estimate at completion will depend how you understand the scenario in the exam. Estimate at completion will depend on your performance, how you are performing. Depending on your performance, you can exactly tell that what kind of formula you can do. First of all, let's consider the angle. So now we'll discuss about what? Let me just put red, because this is one of the main topic here, which is about what? The estimate at completion. Estimate at completion, in the ideal scenario, okay, it will be equal to what? Budget at completion. This is again ideal. This is by angels only. Let's see. Ideal. Okay, which rarely the case. Another approach is that I want to do the same performance. So for example, I started my project with about performance, and I believe I will continue the same from now until the end of the project, okay, with the same performance. The performance will not change, okay? So what formula will you use? I want to incorporate my performance. So the other formula will be what? The budget at completion, incorporating what the performance. So it will be what? The cost performance index. This is in case you want to incorporate your what? Your cost performance. Or you could, for example, do what? BAC over SPI if you want to incorporate your schedule performance. Put in mind that this is not available, okay? Okay, honestly, maybe I don't have the experience to tell you why, honestly speaking. Why? Because I did not see a formula. But in my mind, I'm telling Muhammad, maybe I want to incorporate my performance in the schedule. So this could be a right formula. However, this is not mentioned in the formula sheet. I'm just giving to you, just. But again, what when I will use this formula, if I am considering that my performance will continue the same from day one to the end. Okay, same performance, same manpower, same everything. So that's why this is the easiest way to calculate my estimate at completion. So just forget about this because it's not really mentioned. Okay, can you see that? So it makes sense. If we said before that if my CPI is above one, okay, I'm doing good. Okay, so can you, if you see here, if it is above one, the ratio will be less. So I need less budget at the end of the project. Okay? Think of this later on when you do your homework. Okay? This is one approach. Again, I will put here, this is the ideal scenario. This is if my performance will be the same. Okay? What's the other scenario I may have? So here, case one, case two, case three. Case three, maybe I did a lot of crap in the beginning. I started my project with bad starting, but later on, I believe I will continue the same as plan. Same as plan. Maybe it was only the starting. I have already a very good plan, but I started my project with bad starting. That's why I will put my actual cost, just because I did a bad starting, so I need to see the actual cost. However, I want to say that I will continue the same. I will continue with the same plan. So that's why what will be here, over here, it will be what the S, it will be the budget at completion minus EV. Just focus on this. Understand this over here. How much I need to, like assuming that, for example, if you go to the lifespan over here, okay, from here up to here, assuming that my budget will be the same, okay, I will just see the scope of work that was completed, okay, and I will subtract that scope of work from my budget to know how much left in the budget. So that's why this is how it's represented by what? The budget at completion minus the AV. So I'm just subtracting what the budget, the amount of money I have, minus how much the scope that I have completed worth of money. Okay? And this will give you the budget you need to complete the remaining work. And this, the actual cost, will cover the past, the crap that you have done before. Okay? Some of you will say, okay, Muhammad, but I want to also, in addition to that, I want to incorporate my schedule performance and cost performance to this formula. So what I will do over here, it will be the same formula. But what I will do, I will incorporate my SPI times my CPI. If you see, it's the same as this one, but maybe one times one over here it was. Okay, but here I'm incorporating my schedule performance and cost performance. And again, when I'm supposed to use this, if I started my estimate, if I started my project with bad start, but I'm assuming I will continue as planned. Okay, so this will represent what? The continuation as planned. This will represent the continuation as planned, but I want to be put extra precautions by incorporating the cost performance and the schedule performance. So this is what this is case four. Let's say case five, which is the last case. The guy, the original estimator, is a bad estimator. Okay, the cost baseline, my original estimates are flawed. They are useless. Okay, that's why I need to re-estimate again. That's why. It will be the actual cost, because خلاص, I need to pay whatever amount I paid so far, plus ATC bottom up. It means I will re-estimate again the remaining scope of work. How much does it estimate? So I'll do the same. If you remember, we have three types of estimation. I will use the bottom up. It means the estimate is flawed. It is useless. So I will try to break down again the WBS. I'll go to the activities and I'll do the estimation again. Okay. That's why, and I don't think this you'll find it in the exam, because how you will do bottom-up estimation? This is just for your science, for your knowledge, okay? So, this is the estimate at completion. What is the remaining? We have finished, خلاص. So, we have another formula called what? The variance at completion. What's the variance at completion, which is basically what? The budget at completion. Minus what? The estimate at completion. Simple. What's the variance at completion? At the closeout. How much my original budget minus how much my actual budget that I spent. Again, if it is positive, I'm doing good. If it is negative, I'm doing bad. I mean, positive is I'm doing good. If it's negative, I'm doing bad. Okay? The last formula, and we'll close the formula chapter. It is to complete performance index, Chinese, okay? Always translate this. I will just make it to you in simple terms. How much scope left? Now I want you to derive for me the formula. How much scope left, okay, to how much budget left, okay, to complete. It means I want to measure my performance. It's the same as the previous, but you have different way to measure your performance, okay? Now, how much scope left? How you can measure this, okay? How much scope left? Basically, it's the budget at completion. Minus what? Minus EV. Because I want to see how much scope left. How much budget left? It will be budget at completion. Minus what? Actual cost. Okay? But again, this is in the ideal case. That's why I will not use this. I will use instead. It will be the same, budget at completion minus EV to account for how much scope left over what estimate at completion minus what minus actual cost. Can you see the difference? This is budget at completion, this is budget at completion. To make it clear, this is realistic, this is more realistic, this is maybe ideal. Because you are estimating that the budget that will be at the end of the project will be the same as what the budget at completion. That's why I don't recommend you to do it. Now the question is, Muhammad, do you need really to tell people how to do this? Believe me, if you understand this, the main issue is not a matter of memorizing the formula. How to apply the formula? How to translate the information in the question and use the right formula. This is the most difficult part in the PMP exam. That's why you will only appreciate what I have done the moment you go and solve exam questions. You'll find a lot of words that you need to translate. Same with the physics, if you remember on the physics, okay? The main difficult part is not the formula. Formula, I can, they will even give you the formula sheet in the physics exam, if you remember. They will tell you, if you khair, ruh hal. Do it. We give you the formula sheet, go and do it. Okay, so it's not a matter of the formula, it's a matter of how to take the information from the question and apply it in the right place. Now, I will give you 2 minutes, then we'll, this is the last thing, we need to see the application of these formulas, okay? Okay, just have 2 minutes. We'll come back in 28, okay? خلاص هانت درست question on bye bye exercise. I hope you had the time maybe to read the question. So the exercise is telling you here, you have a project to build a new fence. The fence will form a square as shown at right. Each side is to take one day to build. Always try to write. So you will take what? One day per side. Okay? Or let's say one side per day. Okay? This is the first thing in here. Each side will take one day to build. And 1,000 has been budgeted per side, okay? So it's $1,000 per side, okay? The sides are planned to be completed one after the other, okay? So basically, he's telling you that you cannot do two sides in parallel. I can only start the, it's like there is a finish to start requirement over here. I need to finish the first side, then I can start the second side, then I can start the third side, okay? So this is to show you the sequence. The main thing in here, the main information over here is telling you today is what? The end of day three, okay? Using the following status chart, calculate AV, PV, and spaces. Basically, he wants us to calculate everything over here, okay? So let us just understand the question. And basically, after that, we'll just come up with what, with the elements over here. We said that the planned value, how much I am supposed to pay by the third day. If you understand the question over here, he's telling you that you have a fence, and each fence will take one day. Okay, and the cost to build one side is what? $1,000 per what? Per side. Okay. So he's telling you the planned value by day three, because this is day three he's telling you, okay? So by day three, how much I should have spent by day three? He told me that what? He told me that each side will be completed in one day, right? And I have how many days? 3 days. So By the end of day three, I should have completed three. This is the plan, okay? So that's why PV will be three times what? 1,000. So that's what will become how much? $3,000. Okay? What about the EV? EV will just see how much you have completed by the end of day three. So can you see here? I have day one. I have already, mashallah, finished side one. Day two, no, unfortunately, I was supposed to finish in day two, but this got delayed. That's why in day three, I finished the second side in the, let's say, in the middle of day three. Then I started what? The third side, okay? And I couldn't finish. And as a result, this is, again, has been delayed to day four. So as you can see here, by the end of day three, I need to see how much scope I have completed. I'm focusing on the scope. When it's EV, I'm focusing on the scope. That's why, if you can see here, I have completed already the first side. I have completed the second side by day two. And I have only completed 50% of what? Of the third side. So it's simply what? The EV is what? I have completed the first side. And I have completed the second side. And I have completed 50% of what? Of the third side. And this is multiplied by the cost per side, which will lead to what? 2,500. Did you see? The scope, the end value is related to what? To the scope completed. I'm not focusing on the plan. I'm not focusing on the time. I'm focusing on the scope over here. The actual cost, how much actually I have spent. So if you refer back to the question, he's telling you here what? This, you have spent already, mashallah, 1,000 as planned. here you spent 1,200, so you spent $200 extra. Here you have spent what? 600. So the actual cost will be the summation of these highlighted numbers. So it will be simply what? 1,000 plus 1,200 plus what? 600. And this will lead to how much? $2,800. Okay? Balance at completion. Here is the trick. Okay? Which formula I need to use? If you go to the question, he did not tell you, well, you are going to progress, you know, as planned. You will continue the same performance. He did not tell you explicitly what. He did not tell you, well, originally the we start with bad estimation, then we'll continue as planned. You didn't see this. This is how exam questions, you need to really measure which formula to use. If you look at here, mashallah, on the first day I was doing very good. Okay? And here, I have what? I have spent extra how much? $200. If you can see here, okay? Because the cost per side is $1,000. But here, I have spent additional $200. Okay? So I have bad performance over here. Okay? And I can see in the third day how much extra I have spent. 50%, I'm supposed to spend how much? 500, right? But here I spent how much? 600. So I have an additional of how much? 100, okay? Can you see there's a linear increase? So I'm expecting by day three, if I complete one full side, I will spend 1,200. Again, in the first day, mashallah, as planned, 1,000. The second day, I have additional 200. And the third day, what happened? 50%. 50% as per plan, I should complete half, I should charge only 50%, which is 500. But here I have spent 600. So I have an additional of what? 100% for the 50%. So I'm doing the same trend. Same trend, that's why you'll use which formula? I'm expecting to go with the same performance. So I'll use the formula, which is what? Which is the budget at completion over what? Over the CPI. Okay? And as you're aware that the budget at completion will be what? We have one side which will cost you 1,000 times four sides. So it's four times what? 1,000. Over what's the cost performance index? It is what? It is EV over what? Over AC, right? Which is equal to 4,000 over what? EV, AC, what's gonna be the, just do the calculations, okay? So I'll just take the value over here, 2,500 over AC, which is what? 2,800. You'll get a value over here, which is for sure what? It will be, if you do the calculation, let me cheat, get it from the second page. So the budget at completion will be what? It will be 4479, okay? 4479. So can you see here, your original budget was what? 4,000. Now I have what? Additional $479 I need, okay? Can you see that? This is the budget at completion. This is the way how to calculate it. Then this is a direct form application of the formula. Cost variance is what? EV minus what? Actual cost. I have already all the values. And again, if it's above, if it's positive, I'm doing good. If it's negative, I'm doing bad. And you'll find this clearly over there. Same thing with the CPI. Which is what? Oh, sorry. This is what? This should be where? For the estimate at completion. Which is should be here, okay? And this one, the budget at completion, as we said before, it's four times 1,000, which is what? $4,000. which is the budget at completion. The SPI is what? EV over AC. Apply the formula. SV is what? EV, the scope minus the time, which is planned value. This one will be what? EV over PV. Estimate to complete will be simply what? My estimate at completion minus AC, direct application of the formula. Then this will be what? Budget at completion minus what? Minus estimate at completion. And then it's very important that you go to the notes and you understand the meaning of these. The main thing is to understand the meaning of the values we got already. Okay? Alhamdulillah, we end our PMP program. Not really PMP program, still have one remaining session that we will cover, inshallah, on the next Sunday. Okay? I have for you a homework, that exercise two that you need to do later on. Please make sure that you do it so you make best use of these exercises. It's available already in the notes. Okay. So having said that, alhamdulillah, khalas, we have completed everything in our PMP. We have understood what we should be doing in the initiation, what we should be doing in the planning and the execution and the monitoring, the controlling and closing. Okay. And we saw in the today in the monitoring and controlling what are the different processes we are doing in the monitoring and controlling. And also we saw in the closing that khalas, we hand over the product to the customer and we will solicit his feedback, because there is a possibility that I'm going to be the project manager for the same client again. So I need to build good reputation before I say bye-bye. And I hope I build a good reputation with you as well, my customers. Inshallah, you have enjoyed what we have explained so far. And now it's the time to have your questions, if you have any. So let's just go ahead with your questions. Let us see if you have any questions. خلاص, yeah. Let us ask the questions. Now, خلاص, let me see the chat. Just, let's see, Asim, he's saying, just to be clear, some changes do not need to go through the change control board. Is this right? Yes, you are right. The change request, basically, you have guidelines, right? The change management plan will give you the criteria for the changes, okay? It will tell you explicitly what are the changes that require the project manager approval and what are the changes that require the change control board approval. Some changes that does not need, maybe it's already within the tolerance. Because, you know, when you put the baseline, there is a tolerance level. So maybe if it's within the tolerance level, خلاص, no need to do the change request at all. Because this will be set in the change management plan. You have the guidelines, okay? That will tell you exactly what you should do. Any other questions other than Asim? Let me see. What is BAC? It's budget at completion, okay? Let me go with Wasim. Yes, Wasim, go ahead. Walaikum Salaam.
Muhammad, I have one question regarding this schedule variance. We are measuring the schedule variance in dollar, but always our schedule is in time. Why not measuring like behind the schedule with 10 days, 20 days? Why in the dollars? And what is this meaning? If schedule variance is $1,000, what does it mean?
Look. First of all, when we talk about the schedule variance, okay? It's true they have all the same unit, which is dollar, okay? But the dollar referring to different thing. For example, the planned value. When you talk about the planned value, okay? Mm-hmm. This is the dollar I need to spend by that date, okay? Planned value, yes. Okay? This is the amount of dollar I need to spend in that date. So I'm relating the money to that date, to a time, okay?
So the plan value is understandable, but schedule variance is not understandable, because variance is the difference between actual and the planned. So yeah, schedule
will... Again, put in mind that how I came up with these variables, the basis was time, okay? The base, I know, when you come to the subtractions, these are dollars, okay? But again, it is the formula. mainly need to understand that how I came up with these numbers by the, by an input from the time, okay? How I came up with the bland value, I refer back these to the time, okay? That's why I came up with that dollar value. So the subtractions, that time is already incorporated over there, okay? So just understand this, and I believe this will be clear the moment you go over the exercises. You'll start understanding this. Today was a heavy session. That's why I'm not expecting you to since this is the last lecture, okay, I will be sharing the link with you all, okay? So you can also review this again and make the most out of this, okay?
Okay.
Agreed?
Thank you.
Welcome. Any other questions? Let me see. EAC could be changed. Is that required change request, which may go through CCB? Well, again, you are forecasting, right? Now, based on my performance, I'm estimating how much my project will cost me. Oh, my project will cost me an additional $500. For sure, you need to a change request to change the baseline, okay? Because your approved budget is 4,000 in our example, okay? So now I need 4,479, I believe. So I need an additional amount of $479. So I need a change request to approve the additional what? 479. Unless this is part of my risk management. Maybe this was an identified risk. So this additional money that came, it is because of what a risk that I have identified early on. So this money will not be done by change request. It will be part of what? It will be part of the contingency reserve that was already approved. Again, very important point over here. Now, if this kind of change in the budget is because of unidentified risk, okay, then the money I need to take it from where? From the contingency reserve. So no need for change request over here, okay? However, if this kind of change came because of something that is unidentified before, then it is something that rework. Then I need to submit change request to approve the additional 479, I believe, in our example. Okay, I believe Mr. iPhone Ahmed I hope it's clear for you now. Any other questions? Any questions before we say bye-bye? Why you guys are shy? This is the last lecture. You are shy. Muslim, speak out. Don't turn on the camera. Is it mandatory for the change request to go through control processes to go to 4.6? Can you speak out so we hear from you? 4.6, first of all, this is the same question as your colleague. Is mandatory for the change request to go through integrated processes? It's the same as the question that the guy said CCB. Again, any change request will go to the integrated change control. Okay. However, that integrated change control could be a person who's putting the approver. Depend how severe the change. So the integrated change control process, it could be performed by a person like me who will do the change without requesting the PM approval, or I could be requesting the PM approval, or I could be requesting the CCB. It depends on the guidelines available in the change control plan, the change management plan. The change management plan will give you the guidelines how to conduct that change management in your project. So yes, any change request will go to the integrated change control, but again, not all changes will go to the CCB. Maybe not all changes will go to the PM. Why? It depends. Maybe the change control board will tell you the type of changes that does not require the project manager. Because maybe you are in a project that is having empowering. Okay? Another question, he said, what? Net present value. Net present value, this is one of the economic and calculations you do to award, to justify the the authorization of a project. So if you go back to the integration process early on, okay, during the development of the charter, I used MPV to prove to my customer that I can, I'm having a project that bring a profit. So the moment I have a positive NPV, it means there is a profit. Because what's NPV? Net present value, which is basically how much the value in the present over the cost. Just refer back to the beginning of the initiation, you'll find a brief explanations of the net present value. Okay, same thing with the return on investment. Just refer back to the economic analysis, you'll find the difference. Okay, it's very easy. Just refer back to the introduction of the integration and read a book, to be specific. It will give you all of these details about return on investment, the NPV, the present value, all the accounting elements. Okay, and this is basically done by whom? By the BA, as you said, Yusuf, by the business analyst. Okay. Now, let us see if we have any further questions. Just go ahead. If you have any questions, don't worry. If you don't have any more questions, please feel free to ask if you have any. One, two, three, four, and five. See you, inshallah, in our upcoming review session. Work hard and see you, inshallah, next lecture. As-salamu.